I see you have our missing property. I see you have our missing property. Great. Well, at least it's nice out.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain.
I see you have our missing property.
Life is all there, older than the trees, younger than the
mountains. Maybe some extra patrols over there.
Like the breeze, country roads.
The quicker you recover our missing equipment, the better.
To the base, I belong.
I see you have our missing property.
Mountain mama.
All these newcomers make me nervous.
I'm gonna need more. Alright, I'm back with my prop alcohol. Really gives you the illusion that you're day drinking. ReReviews! Fallout 76! Just for the record, before I start, I know that I look very disheveled. I was gonna clean up before I did this video, and then I realized, no, actually, this makes more narrative sense. Pre-review! Yeah, I was one of the idiots. You know the ones. The ones that watched that Bethesda live stream leading up to the announcement of what was going to be Fallout 76. Just watching, like, the bobbleheads and stuff. Yeah, I checked in on that periodically, and I was there when the actual trailer dropped for 76, and you got the Take Me Home Country Roads, and you got the impression that this was going to be another full-fledged Fallout game, and that it was going to look basically like Fallout 4, sorry to say, but it did. And that it was going to just take you to this new place that, you know, you're going to a new location. That's really all the initial trailer told me. But, you know, whatever. It was a new Fallout game. Excuse me. Yeah. New Fallout game. And it wasn't long after that, though, when we started to get more information about what this game probably was, and people started talking about it being more like a Rust clone, you know, an actual, like, big open-world survival game. Since I started playing Fallout games with 3, this was, like, the first one that I had basically no interest in playing. I didn't care if I ever did. It was the kind of thing where it's like, I'm not gonna rush out to the store, I'm not going to, like, pre-order it, I'm not gonna buy it. If I rent it or something, if it comes from, like, Gamefly, I'll do it. I'll play it. I'll see how it is. But I was in no rush, no hurry to play this thing. And that's why I give it a 4 out of 10 on pre-review. Review! Okay, let's start with the good stuff. I liked what they did with the special stats in Fallout 76. I know, I actually did like that. Every character, regardless of how you start out, every character is going to start with 1 in each of those special stats. So you're starting at the lowest possible number that is in a Fallout game for everything across your categories. And when you level up, you get to put a point into one of those special stats. That all equates to some passive stuff like your carrying capacity or your health or your AP, whatever. But it also has a more active effect that you get to put these cards in. So you get to figure out how you want to rearrange your character and mod it out. And you can, you know, find and replace and switch cards out depending on what you want to do, the situation that you're in. You're free to, like, customize your character on the fly if you so choose. The reason why this system works pretty well is anyone coming into this fresh, knowing that you can't, like, just load up an old save, because you can't in this game, it allows you to really get a feel for the game right up at the front, and then as you go along, you can keep modding out your character. So everyone's going to find their strengths and their weaknesses as they play the game, and then you can keep developing your character based on that. So I liked that mechanism. That was a neat, innovative thing that they added in. And also the soundtrack had some good songs. It wasn't just Country Roads. There were some other ones on there that were pretty great. Okay, now the bad stuff. Literally everything else about the game. So I could start talking to you about bugs, glitches, problems associated with the game. To be honest with you, I don't really want to. Bethesda has always had that problem. No, I am not letting them off the hook for it. No, I am not going to make excuses for them. The only thing is that there's really no reason to go into detail on it. It's always there. It's in this one. They haven't changed. And granted, that is going to affect my score and my view of the game. But I would much rather talk to you about legitimate game design decisions. Decisions that Bethesda made when they built this crap. Okay, so your stash has a weight limit. There isn't a single game in the Fallout franchise where they put a weight limit on your stash. Why? Because they're asking you to pick up literally everything except the kitchen sink. Basically, so you can construct a kitchen sink. They want you to pick up everything, and since we're basically in survival mode in this one, there isn't a way around that. Everything, including like ammunition in this version, has weight. All right, and while we're at it, you can also contract things like diseases and everything like that. So you've got to keep, hoarding things like food so that you can make medicines, so that you can keep curing yourself from all of the random diseases that you're going to get. You're gonna get encumbered very fast, and so you kind of need a stash so that you could put all of that various crap that they made you pick up into a place, and then they put a weight limit on that. You only have the one stash. It is a combined stash, so wherever you find your stash box, it's gonna be that stuff, but there's only a limited amount that you can put into it. Now, this is not just a Fallout 76 problem. This is in most multiplayer games, but it doesn't make it any less annoying. While we're talking about bad game decisions they made, food degrades. I swear. So now you gotta use your food up, or it's gonna go bad really fast, actually. And a returning mechanic from 3 and New Vegas that they gladly got rid of in 4 and then thought, no, we're bringing it back, is that your weapons and your armor also break down and you have to constantly repair them. Unlike those older games where you could actually utilize other pieces of armor and weapons in order to repair that, in this particular iteration, what they said is, no, you don't have that option. You have to use those spare parts, you know, those bunch of spare parts that you can't fit into your damn stash that we made you pick up along the way? Yeah, you gotta use that to repair. Or, if you want the premium part, you could also buy the repair pack. But again, that wasn't when I originally played the game. This was, like, right at launch. They didn't even have that. No, just find the supplies around, folks, and if you don't, then your armor breaks and it does basically nothing. Oh, what else? Vats. Doesn't work. Yeah, that's the saving grace of the series, because the shooting, let's face it, in Fallout has never been a strong feature of the game, and I think Bethesda always knew that. So what they did is utilize VATS, which was a classic part of the series, you know, from the very beginning, to create a tactical overlay so that it augmented the fact that the shooting wasn't that good.
All right, no one in the clubhouse. Terrific. All right. Nothing up here, right? No. No one. Good. Oh, okay. Here we go. Here's one. Oh, that's a high level. Okay, there's another one. Okay, there's another. Okay, where the hell did you all come from? Okay, how are you all here? Okay, I'm gonna just leave now. I guess I'm gonna just go. Okay, and, alright, I'm dead.
But in this one, VATS ended up feeling like it worked less effectively somehow than if you just aimed at the target. Because if I aim at the target, I pretty much know that I'm going to hit the target because I'm aiming at it. But then if I hit the vat and I have the overlay, all of a sudden I have a percentage to hit. And if they go behind like one post for a second, all of a sudden my chances go down to zero. Now, if you're using a bolt action or a sniper rifle, anything like that, it's going to be a little while until you can get back on track and take another shot. I think I would have really preferred to just stay in a just sighted mode, which is what I did for the majority. It's one of the first times I was in a Fallout game where I didn't want to use VATS, which is just weird, man. The leveling of monsters in this game is all over the place. Oh, by the way, monsters now have levels too. You end up with level numbers for every enemy that you encounter. And this might be okay. You could find like low level areas and higher level areas and go to those. But the problem is, I couldn't find any kind of consistency with those levels. You know, suddenly you would just run into an enemy that is just a higher level than you, and there was like no warning, no reason for it.
All right, going into the power station. Oh, okay. Lone Reaver there. Wow.
Better yet, weapons have levels associated with them. So if you pick up a weapon and you're not a high enough level yet, you can't actually use it. And that leveling problem is gonna come back to haunt us even more, but we'll get to that in the ReReview part. Needless to say, the whole thing feels very disjointed. And the fact that there weren't any NPCs, there's no human characters in it, made this world feel incredibly disparate. Yeah, it's big. I'll grant it that. It's so big that I still, even after going back and replaying it, have not seen all the different areas of the game. But if you're not populating it with anything interesting, why do you have it? There's no real reason to have the map be that big. It's the problem with space games, you know, like No Man's Sky. Yeah, it's infinitely large. It's a procedurally generated universe. So why didn't people play it endlessly? Because there wasn't a lot of content involved. Fallout 76 is basically like that. Not a great comparison to have, mind you. I'll grant that it does feel enough like a Fallout game that you could be tricked into thinking that you were playing a Fallout game. But ultimately, it's hard to feel like this is a legitimately a Fallout game, because so many of the hallmarks, which is another video that I did, don't seem to be there. Okay, let's just put this thing out of its misery. On review, I give this a 3 out of 10. Alright, here we go. ReReview!
Use the emergency code, please.
Access code received.
Yay.
Validating code.
Mm-hmm.
Confirming identity.
Yep.
Accepted.
Great.
Welcome, Commander Daguerre. Transmitting encryption key as mm-hmm. requested. Terminating transmission.
Right.
This unit will now continue to USSA custody.
Okay. Okay, warning. Get me out of the... Yeah, get me out of the conversation. Kind of... Yeah, gonna have to cut this a little short.
So going back, I can tell you that all the bugs and glitches, there's still plenty of those. So again, not gonna belabor that point. It's there, it doesn't help its score, it doesn't help my impressions of the game. But not gonna go into much detail on that. One thing that I didn't notice so much the first time as I did now is that whole leveling system that I was mentioning earlier. And I don't know if it's just because now there's like level 130s running around the same game world as me, who is still, because I walked away from the game for so long, only like level 30, 20 something, I don't remember. But all of a sudden, you just keep running into enemies that are like level 60. Like they're 30 levels higher than you. And I don't know what would happen if you had, like, a newbie, because I did. There were several servers where I saw people that were coming in at level 1, and there are people who are level 130 or something. Now, I don't know if they're looking at it from different areas where they're trying to average out the level for the people that are in that area, but it did not seem to be very consistent, because I would get into areas where I, from my map, was the only person around, and still I was encountering monsters that were way higher level. And then I go to another area, and again, I seem to be the only person in the area, and the enemies are like 20 levels below me. I don't understand this. Is that supposed to be the way it's played? Because you're giving me missions. Literally, you're giving me missions, main missions, that are asking me to go to those places with enemies that are much higher level than me. Was that accounted for? Because in the middle of putting levels on literally everything, like your weapons and the monsters, mind you, something they apparently didn't do was put levels on the missions. I don't understand that. You would think that if they were so level crazy about everything, that would be the one big indicator I could take away from seeing like how difficult a mission is. And if it's in flux, I don't even understand how they calculate that. It just... Oh God. This is gonna get worse, isn't it? Yeah. I did not play the Nuclear Winter Battle Royale mode. I am very disappointed that the Battle Royale mode was such a heavy focus for Bethesda, because I don't think they really understand their audience at this point. I would also like to say that I'm not going to go into a lot of detail now about all of the various controversies that happened around this game, whether it be about canvas bags, or Fallout First subscriptions, or, you know, materials box for all of your junk that then lost all of your junk, which is a premium feature, mind you, or having like the NCR Ranger armor that everyone was hoping would come out in the game and then putting that behind a paywall, or hey, a battle pass or whatever they have now, season, you can get season passes, which apparently is a different thing from Fallout. I'm cutting this off right now. I'm not going to get into all of those controversies again. Trust me, that affects its rating. It does not improve the game or what the game is in my eyes whatsoever. And the very idea that the team had to come out basically at E3 and admit that they were putting out a bad game, it has spoiled me on Bethesda for a good long time. It's going to take a hell of a lot to get me back on the Bethesda train. Or Bethesda boat. I guess that makes more sense. It's a Bethesda boat. A slow boat to nowhere. But the real reason I wanted to talk about this now is I had said that if I ever got the opportunity to just play the game where I didn't have to pay for it, after Wastelanders came out, I would do that. So Wastelanders came out, and they had free play days on my Xbox. So I played it for the weekend. It met my criteria, so here we are.
Honey, you picked the wrong time to get a drink.
What are you? Hey, who the hell are you?
All right, so I'm not going to lie to you. Wastelanders does add something to Fallout 76 that it desperately needed. The Fallout part.
What are you... Shit. Jammed. Fine. But none of us are going anywhere till I get what I want. So just start talking and we can all go about...
I told you it was going to end badly.
You realize how much you really needed the connection of characters that were like living, interactable characters in the game to make the game world feel alive. Radical, I know. The game world didn't feel alive when there were no living creatures in it to interact with. Go figure. And they do some interesting things with that. The way that they handle the like personal story elements where you make decisions is there are instances that you go into, and in those instances, it's basically like the single player part, and you start to realize, oh yeah, single player Fallout, that's always fun. Wish the whole game was like that. And so you make decisions inside of that, although I don't really know what kind of decisions you can make. It didn't feel like I had a ton of options. Either, I don't know, go along with the character who's giving you the mission, or I don't know, shoot everybody. I guess those are your options. I don't really know. You do those instances, you come out of those instances, the game saves, and you go on your merry way and do the missions in the overworld, which is now back to being the multiplayer. And yeah, this feels a bit disjointed, but I'm also sitting there thinking to myself, I don't really know how they could have done that better, because they're working with what they got here. So whatever, it's fine. It's a little awkward, but it's fine. I like that there are settlements now. I like that you can actually trade with characters that are not just like the Protectrons. It feels a little bit more like a Fallout game, but it's just that it feels a little bit more like a Fallout game. There's still not nearly as much content or depth or consequence to your actions as there was in a Fallout 4, 3, New Vegas, you name it. And that's really the thing that disappoints me more than anything. And I knew it was going to disappoint me going in, and I was just hoping maybe I was wrong. Maybe this would impress me. And while I can tell you that Wastelanders is definitely an improvement on the formula, it definitely helps. It doesn't really help it enough to make the game good. There are some innovative things that they did with this, like, for instance, the allies. You'll come across different characters in the game that have more drawn-out stories, and you can actually have them come back to your camp, you know, which is essentially what they did with the building aspect from 4. They made a camp that you can set up and then reset up later. But you can have those allies come back to the camp, and you can have one at a time. The one that I ran across was the astronaut, and she was trying to find the rest of her crew and everything like that. Oh, that's neat. That's neat. It gives a little bit of that, like, NPC follower dynamic, although they don't really go with you out onto the into the wastelands. I mean, yeah, it definitely improves some things that didn't work very well at the beginning, like, you know, the fact that the Overseer is completely known through audio logs you pick up. Well, now the Overseer is an interactable character. You know, you actually meet the Overseer and find out what's happened to her. That's neat. From a narrative standpoint, if you were playing from the beginning, this doesn't necessarily make a hell of a lot of sense, why all of a sudden there's just a bunch of people around, and that, like, all of the stuff that you might have been doing originally is sort of completely changed. Like, it's a very revisionist story now because of Wastelanders. However, I imagine that if you're coming into this fresh with a new character, which I didn't really get the opportunity to do, that's the one thing I would have liked to do, but then my time ran out. If you're coming in as a new character, you're not going to see problems with it, because this is the way the Wasteland is now. And so coming into it fresh, you know, this is just the way the Wasteland is of West Virginia. I guess you have to wonder, after a year and a half, how many of these people are new players? Again, I told you, I was running into a bunch of servers where there's just, like, a group of characters that are over level 100 running around in the high-level areas of the game. Maybe they're high levels, maybe they're level 1s over there, I don't know. Again, the leveling system is weird. But obviously they've been playing for a really long time, for reasons.
All right. Good stuff. Okay, where's your friend? Okay, all right. Damn it.
So I imagine the majority of the players for Fallout 76 today are going to be experiencing that weird, like, well, we're rewriting basically the whole story.
Nuclear strike imminent.
Wait, what? What? Where? Wait, what? What the? Oh, damn it!
All right, I'm almost at the bottom of this shot glass, so the overarching problem of Fallout 76 is that you realize that no matter how much time Bethesda ends up spending on this game, no matter how long they try to support it for, even with Wastelanders, which was supposed to be the big revolution of this title a year and a half after its launch, it still will not have nearly as much content or fun associated with it as any other Fallout game, and those are a fraction of the price. They already have a ton of released add-on content, and you actually feel like you have agency in that world, and you actually feel like things that you do have consequences. And I know that a lot of people might not have been super on board for Fallout 4. It had a hard time. It was coming off of New Vegas, which, again, like, the best Fallout. But Fallout 4, which is the best comparison you can make to 76, because they look basically the same. Most of the assets are the same. Fallout 4, especially with the mod community, which is just disallowed from 76, because, again, it's a big multiplayer game, you can't do that, it has so much content associated with it. Content that's still coming out for it now. And just the basic stuff that Bethesda put into it, the world, even though it's a fraction of the size of 76, still feels like there's so much more to do inside of it. And, you know, I didn't have to worry about so many things like the weapon degradation and the food degradation and the stash limits and anything like that, which I understand they had to put all of that in because it's a multiplayer game, and so it can't be single-player centric, but that's kind of the whole problem. Fallout's supposed to be a single-player experience. That's why people loved the series. I don't know a single person who said to themselves, Fallout's great, but you know what would be even better? If it was a multiplayer game. And now that we see all of the sacrifices that you have to make in order for a multiplayer Fallout to work, I don't like it. And I know that they're never going to be able to make it as good as any other Fallout game that previously came out. And nothing that they're going to be able to do, no amount of fixing, no amount of patching, no amount of updates, if Wastelanders 3.0, 4.0, 5.0, whatever they come up with after this, the seasonal stuff that they're doing, you know, all of the events that they want to put in, anything like that, the whole new roadmap of content that they've created for the future, nothing they do is ever going to get them back to the point that any other Fallout game has already achieved. So what's the point? Because of all of that, folks, I can't do it. Fallout 76 on ReReview gets a 2 out of 10. I give it a 2 only because, like, Wastelanders is content that really should have been there from the beginning. And it wasn't, but at least I guess they did the bare minimum of a year and a half later coming out with it. So there's that. I give it at least a modicum of credit because the things that did work still kind of work, and that they did try to add new stuff into it. However, remember all of those controversies and the problems that they had and the subscription models and, you know, coming out and saying that, well, we kind of knew the game was going to be bad. And the continuing problem of glitches, and yeah, you get it. All of those problems. It's going to get a 2 out of 10, and I don't have any interest in playing this thing ever again, but Lord knows, probably will. Damn it.
Seriously, thank you for sticking your neck out for me.
Alright, so that was me going back into Fallout 76. Yep. It wasn't an enjoyable experience. But you know what? I never said that ReReviews were supposed to be enjoyable for me. They're just going back, looking at games I had already played, and seeing how they hold up. And it's probably no surprise that 76 didn't. I'm going to give you a little recap just so you can see all the scores together like I usually do. And I know that in recent years, especially since 76 came out, and I guess Blades too, I've been very critical of Bethesda, but I feel like that's warranted. I was very much in Bethesda's camp before all of this, and I stuck by them for a very long time because although they had glitches, although they had problems, although they had done a lot of things that are questionable, they were trying to produce these very big, very epic, very ambitious titles. And it felt like when they got to 76, they wanted to cash in all of their goodwill to make this, you know, cash grab game that would capitalize on Fallout as a brand so that they could get people to pay them a bunch of money before they even put in most of the work. I didn't like that, and I didn't support that. And when I played it, I realized just how sad this was. Fallout 70 sad. Sorry, hashtag Fallout 70 sad. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to dislike and unsubscribe, and I guess maybe I'll see you on the next one. Probably won't. I don't know. Why do I keep making these videos? I don't know. I'm so... Oh, right. I'm out. Damn it. There is one other thing that I think is worth noting. When I went back into the game, I don't know if it's just my perception changed or if they actually patched this. VATS is a lot more effective now. Like, it feels like it actually does a better job at targeting now. And if they patch that, good. If it's just me, then I was just having a really weird time of it to begin with. I think they probably patched it. Now, that's a good thing, especially in big firefights where you can't stay on target anyway, because most of the time you can't. However, I'm not really going to give them points for that. And the reason is very simple. If you have a kid, right, and they poop on the floor, and you reprimand them for it, and then, like a year later, they pick that poop off the floor and dispose of it, how much credit are you giving that kid? Like, I'm not going to reward them for fixing the crap that they left on my doorstep. You made a mistake out of the gate. You should have fixed it. It's good that you fixed it, but don't think you're going to get credit for it. It shouldn't have been there to begin with. Just watch as somebody tracks me down, puts a bag of flaming dog crap on my... Love Bethesda. That's okay. Putting out a bag of flaming dog crap is probably going to be a more enjoyable experience than playing this game. So,